If you've heard me speak, I always like to start off with a joke. And I have a disclaimer that if you don't like the joke, don't come to me, because I didn't come up with the joke. Now, usually it's my son that comes up with the joke, but he had a walk yesterday, and so my wife came up with the joke. And so I think everybody enjoyed it last time, so I'll start off with a joke. Now, we've been doing a series on relationships, so this is a relationship joke. Shortly before the 25th wedding anniversary, a husband sent his wife 25 long-stem yellow roses to her at her office. A few days later, she plucked all the petals and dried them. On the night of their anniversary, she spread the petals over the bed and laid on them, wearing some lingerie. As she had hoped, she got a reaction from her husband. When he saw her, he shouted, "Are those potato chips?" So, amen. All right, I think y'all enjoy that one. So, it's good to laugh in church. You know, the Bible says, if anyone speaks, let him speak the words of God. If anyone ministers, let him do with the ability that he supplies. And I always start off because my words is that I will speak God's words. I worked on this for hours. But my prayer is that the anointing of the Holy Spirit will be here, that will make things come alive for you, and you will hear the things that you need to hear. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit will teach you at that time what needs to be said. And so the Holy Spirit will take these words and come alive and give you things that will make a difference in your life. That's my prayer today. And so we've been doing a series on relationships. And our series is From This Day Forward. This is week 3 of a 5-week series. And in the first week, we talked about seeking God. And Pastor Doug shared about that. And there's a lot of good principles. And if you haven't seen it, you can watch it on our website. And then the second one last week was fighting fair, dealing with conflict. Today I'm going to talk about having fun in your relationship. And so the goal of this series is, it doesn't matter where you are today, God wants to move you to a better place. That you may have, things may be going great, but God wants them even to be better. There's always things that we can learn in our relationship. And so that's really what God wants to bring about. Our key verse that we've been sharing in this series is Lamentations 3:19-23. I remember my afflictions and my wanderings, the bitterness and the gall. I will well remember them, and my soul is downcast within me. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning, great is his faithfulness. You know, God desires, I don't know what you've been through in your life. I don't know what maybe the hardships and the sorrows that you've been through from life. And sometimes those things that you go through can stain you. But God wants you to bring you to a better place in your relationship. We've been doing a relationship series, and no matter where you are today, God wants to bring you to a new place. And so as I was putting this together, I thought about something. What would be something to kind of help understand what God desires to do in your life? We have a plumeria plant. We have a couple of plumeria plants. And we have one in the front of our house, and we have one or two in the back of our house. And the plumeria plant cannot stand cold weather. If anything gets close to a frost, it will kill it. So every year we pull up the plumeria plants, and we put them in our garage. And so they're sitting in our garage, and they look dead. If you've ever seen a plumeria plant, I mean, you don't even have to have any dirt on the roots. The roots can be exposed, and you just put them in a warm area or area that doesn't freeze. So we have these plants, and they just look dead. And that could be, in some people, that may be your relationship. It just seems like it looks dead. It seems like nothing's happening. Or and with our plumeria plant, we plant it every year, and there's one particularly that just seems like it never blooms. It was growing, and it had big green leaves, and it gets bigger every year, but it just doesn't bloom. And so somebody shared with us that you need to give that plumeria plant bloom, a super bloom. And in that super bloom, I believe there's phosphorus. And that plumeria plant likes that. And when Sarah started beginning to give in that super bloom to that plant and all of our plants, and believe it or not, that plant all of a sudden started blooming. And the plumeria plant gives off a very fragrant flower, and that's the flower they use with Lay's that they make in Hawaii. So unless there was super bloom, that plant wasn't doing its thing. And I thought about in our own life, sometimes we need a little super bloom in our life. We need a little super bloom in our relationships because God wants us to be all that he desires for us to be in our relationship. And so with that, you have to learn some principles. And so today, my desire is that you get a little super bloom in your relationship, that we give you some principles. No matter if you've got a great relationship, I believe it can get better. But you have to take principles and apply them in your life, just like we have to apply the super bloom of that plant wasn't going to bloom. And so no matter where you are in your relationship, no matter what you've been through, God wants to move you forward to a new place. He wants you to be able to bloom and blossom and be all that he wants you to be. And so today what we're going to talk about is having fun in our relationships and talk about bringing excitement and romance into a relationship so that we can bloom and be all that God wants us to be. He doesn't want us just surviving in our relationship. He wants us thriving in our relationships. Now, one thing I want to share with you, if I look at you, I'm not talking to you. I'm just looking to get my thoughts together, okay? So that's my thing. If I look at you, don't think, well, he's looking at me. He's saying something bad about me. No, I'm not. I'm just looking to get my thoughts together. So have secure. Be secure. Amen? Amen. So principle number one, we're talking about life-giving relationship. God wants you to have a life-giving relationship. Life-giving relationship looks to God as a source of their life. Life-giving relationships look to God as a source of their life. Deuteronomy 30, 19 through 20. Today I have given you the choice between life and death, between blessings and curses. Now I call on heaven and the earth to witness the choice you make. Oh, that you would choose life so that you and your descendants might live. You can make this choice by loving the Lord your God, obeying him, committing yourself firmly to him. This is the key to your life. You know, to have a healthy relationship, I believe it starts by having God as the centerpiece of your relationship. You know, when you get married, you are in a covenant relationship. Marriage is a covenant relationship between you, God, and your spouse. And the Bible says that's like a three-stranded cord that's not easily separated. Having God in your relationship is vital to having a healthy, thriving relationship. That when God is in your relationship, and we're going to learn some principles today, that God, the power, I'm going to share with you a verse I think is really neat. Romans 5:5. For we know how dearly God loves us because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. God is love, so you can love. The Holy Spirit lives inside of you. The God power lives inside of you, so you can love. You can learn to love. You can learn to thrive in love because the life of God lives inside of you, and God is love. Amen. God gives us the power to forgive. If you're in your relationship, and for your relationship to thrive, there has to be a certain amount of forgiveness in that relationship. God, the Holy Spirit, can help you to forgive and overcome no matter what you faced in your life. The Holy Spirit is there to help you through your tough times. He's there to help you through whatever situation that you face. The Holy Spirit, God is an example of unconditional love. He can help you to learn to love your spouse unconditionally, to learn to accept your spouse for who they are, to learn to give that unconditional love. The power of God lives inside of you so that you can do those things. We need God's power inside of us. Philippians 4:19 says, and the same God who takes care of me will supply all your needs from his glorious riches which have been given to us in Christ Jesus. God said he'll supply all of our needs. God is there as your provider in your relationship. He will help you through the tough times. He will help you overcome all the things that you face in your life. The Holy Spirit is there to be your help and your comforter. We need God in our relationships. And so our part is to invite him into our relationship, is to have him be the first part. That's why you're in church, because you want God in your life. You want to tap into the power source. You want the super bloom, the Holy Spirit in your life, so that you're thriving, so that you're blooming, so that you're being all that God desires for you to be. And his power is there through the Holy Spirit. Psalms 127:1. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Now, you can do your own thing and you can build your own relationships. But, you know, when you leave God out, you leave the supernatural out. Amen. And we need a supernatural in our relationships. Amen? Number two, life-giving relationship happen when two servants are in love. Matthew 20, 25 through 28. But Jesus called them together and said, you know that the rulers in this world lord it over their people, and the officials flaunt their authority over those under them. But among you it will be different. Whoever wants to be a leader amongst you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first amongst you must become your slave. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others and to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus did not come to be served. He came to serve. Amen. And so we talked about what in a relationship, a life-giving relationship, happens when two servants come together in love. You want to have a strong relationship, then it starts off by serving your spouse. It starts off in that relationship. It's not what are they doing for you. It's what are you doing for them. See, it's not about selfish love. It's about loving them unconditionally. It's about loving them with the power of the Holy Spirit to love. Now, there's a book called His Needs, Her Needs. And I'm going to take some principles from this book because you need to know in your relationship, if you're a guy, what is my wife's needs? Because your goal is to serve her. And she needs to know what are your needs so she's meeting your needs. That's your focus, is to meeting needs. That's what Jesus came. He came to meet the needs. He came to serve. So for a wife's needs, we'll start with the women first. Number one. And you can write these down. So I also have this. If you want a copy, we can make copies. You can go on the internet and find it. But number one need for a woman, affection. Now, I'm going to actually give you examples, because sometimes when you think affection, if you ask a guy what affection is, you ask a girl what affection is, sometimes they're two different things. So I'll give you a little bit of a definition, okay? So that'll help you here, guys. Her husband tells her that he loves her with words, cards, flowers, gifts, and common courtesies. He hugs her and kisses her many times each day, creating an environment of affection that clearly and repeatedly expresses his love for her. Affection's number one. Number two, conversation. He sets aside time each day to talk to her. They may talk about events in their lives, their children, their feelings, or their plans. But whatever the topic, she enjoys the conversation because it's never judgmental, always informative, and constructive. She talks to him as much as she would like and responds with interest. He is never too busy to just talk. Now, as I'll share these things, I know you're saying, oh my gosh, I don't do this. I will be the first to tell you I don't do all these things. So don't just cross it off your list. These are things that we're striving to do, okay? Number three, honesty and openness. He tells her everything about himself, leaving nothing out that might later surprise her. He describes his positive and negative feelings, events of his past, his daily schedule, and his plans for the future. He never leaves her with a false impression and is truthful about his thoughts, feelings, intentions, and behaviors. Number four, financial support. He assumes the responsibility to house, feed, and clothe the family. If his income is insufficient to provide essential support, he resolves the problem by upgrading his skills to increase his salary. He does not work long hours, keeping himself away from his wife and family, but he is able to provide necessary support by working 40 to 45 hours a week. While he encourages his wife to pursue a career, he does not depend on her salary for family living expenses. Number five, family commitment. He commits sufficient time and energy to the moral and educational development of his children. He reads to them, engages in sports with them, takes them on frequent outings. He reads books and attends lectures with his wife on the subject of child development so they will do a good job training their children. He and she discusses training methods and objectives until they agree. He does not proceed with any plan of training discipline without her approval. He recognizes that the care of the children is critical important to her. So there's the five for the guys. All right, now for the women. The guys go, amen. Now for the women. Here's what y'all need to work on. All right, number one, sexual fulfillment. His wife meets his needs by becoming a terrific sexual partner. She studies her own sexual response to recognize and understand what brings out the best in her. Then she shares the information with him, and together they learn to have sexual relationship that both find repeatedly satisfying and enjoyable. Number two, recreational companionship. She develops an interest in the recreational activities he enjoys most and tries to become proficient at them. If she finds that she can enjoy them, she encourages him to consider other activities that they can enjoy together. She becomes his favorite recreational companion, and he associates her with his most enjoyable moments of relaxation. Number three, physical attractiveness. She keeps herself physically fit with diet and exercise. She wears her hair, makeup, and clothing in a way that he finds attractive and tasteful. He is attracted to her in private and proud of her in public. Number four, domestic support. She creates a home that offers him a refuge from the stresses of life. She manages the household responsibility in a way that encourages him to spend time at home and join his family. Number five, admiration. She understands and appreciates him more than anyone else. She reminds him of his value and his achievements and helps him to maintain self-confidence. She avoids criticizing him. She is proud of him, not out of duty, but from a profound respect for the man she chose to marry. So those are the five needs. And I encourage you that part of the relationship is meeting that spouse's needs, studying those things. We're talking about intimacy in a relationship. It starts off laying the right foundation. And I believe it starts off by meeting needs of one another. So two servants coming together, and part of serving is meeting their needs. Life-giving relationships make the choice every day. Life-giving relationship makes the choice every day. 2 Corinthians 6, 2, indeed, the right time is now. We have a choice every day what we choose to do. We shared earlier that God has to be the source of your relationship for it to thrive. So you have a choice to pursue God in your relationship. You have a choice to follow after him, to lead each other together in your relationship with God and put him the center. You have a choice every day of whether or not you want to serve one another. As I shared before, so often we get caught up, well, my spouse ain't meeting my need. Well, then maybe you need to focus more need on meeting hers. That's loving unconditionally right there. And that's how Jesus came. He was coming to serve. He wasn't coming to, they needed to serve him. And so maybe God wants you to sharpen that up a little bit in your life. So we have a choice every day. Now let's get on to the meat of what we want to talk about, having fun. And so I'm going to start off by sharing with you Ecclesiastes 9:9. Live happily with the woman you love through all the meaningless days of life that God has given you under the sun. The wife God gave you is your reward for all your earthly toil. Another translation of Ecclesiastes 9:9 says, enjoy life with your wife whom you love. God wants us to enjoy one another. God wants us to have fun in our relationships. And so we're talking about having fun, and the first principle is emotional, sharing in the emotional. Now, when I was putting this together, I was thinking, okay, now emotional. For me, I have a hard time necessarily wrapping my hands around the emotional side of it. As a guy, sometimes when you say emotional, it's kind of hard to interpret that. So first off, I began to go back to some of the books, and I pulled some stuff from one of the books that we've taught on before, on Love Life by Dr. Ed Wheat. And he talks about romantic love. So when I say emotional love, I'm talking about romantic love. Now, God wants you in your relationship to enjoy that romantic love. That romantic love is like the fire in your relationship. That romantic love is what brings the energy and the passion in your relationship. And God wants you to continue to cultivate that romantic love. So, being a guy, I need to know, how do we do that? I mean, I'm like a step-by-step, you know, teach me what I need to know about romantic love. So I'm going to help you, for all the guys. And all the women said, amen. So, how do we grow into romantic love? Number one, We need to utilize imaginative thoughts. Now, that's a lot to think about that, okay? We need to utilize imaginative thought. You need to use your faculties of memory and imagination to build romantic love. God wants us to be creative and imaginative in building love in our relationship. Now, I know one thing. Sarah doesn't like routine. She likes me. If I'm going to show love, it needs to be creative. She doesn't put that demand on me. But I know that if I'm creative, then she knows that I did a little work at it. And that's how women, they want to know. If you really cherish them, then show them. Right? Show them the money. I mean, show them that you mean what you say. Okay? And so I wrote down this that Dr. Ed Wheat said, romantic love. It is a pleasurable, learned, that's important. It's a learned. It doesn't necessarily come natural. It's a pleasurable, learned response to the way your partner looks and feels, to the things your partner says and does, to the emotional experiences you share. As you consistently think of these favorable things, your response to them become even more strongly imprinted in your mind. You begin loving through your thought processes. You begin to love through your processes of your thoughts of that person. Now, let me bring it into the spiritual. And God showed me this verse I thought was so good. I never thought of it this way. Philippians 4:8 says, "And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and praiseworthy." You know, building romantic love starts by thinking about that partner, about the good of that partner. Thinking about the things that drew you together. You know, so often what we do is we get caught on the negative and we dwell on the negative. And we start thinking, you start seeing all the little things that are not what you wanted them to be. God wants you to focus on the positive about that person. That's what helps build romantic love. That you begin to say, that you're thankful, that you just think of all of the good things. And that helps to bring about the excitement in your relationship when you dwell on those things that are true, the noble, and just. You know, I wrote down a couple of things. When you're thinking about your partner, you're thinking about the positive experiences that you've had together. You're thinking about the positive side of your partner's character and personality. Those are things that you begin to dwell on, and you're thinking the best, and you believe the best in the person that you love. Those are things that God wants you to focus on and let that create in you a creativity. You know, when I was putting this together, I was thinking about, I'm married to the best wife. I'm sure y'all say that, and I'm going to say I have the best wife, okay? But everybody, you should say the same thing about your spouse. And when I just think about her during the day, I just think, you know, I'm thankful, God. She is so loving. She's so giving. She does so much for people. And I just get excited, and then I just text her. I just got to get it out. I want to share that love. That makes her feel loved, that you share. Don't hold it in. So we're talking about sharing your emotions. Let it out. They need to hear that. Well, I told her I loved her when I married her. No, you tell her every day that you love her. And you let that bubble up inside of you, and you start meditating on those things, and start thinking about those things, and that creative, imaginative side of you begins to show you how can you express that love to your wife, because you want to get it across to her. Use your imagination. We're talking about building romantic love. Number two, building that romantic love starts with the right emotional climate. So let's talk about how to have like a romantic atmosphere. You know, taking time out of your day to just, Sarah and I like to drink coffee together. Just drink coffee together and look at each other eye to eye. Eye to eye contact is important. It's not romantic love when you're looking at your phone and you're talking to her out of the side of your, and you're looking around and you're looking. That's not romantic love. Or that's not, she ain't receiving it as romantic love, I'll tell you right now. Romantic love is looking them in the eye and spending time and putting your phone down and you just having one-on-one time and you got the kids. The kids aren't with you on the couch. The kids are gone. You get away from the kids for a while and you spend time together. It doesn't have to be that you go off on a trip every single week. You can take little timeouts during your day to just spend one-on-one time of just sharing time together. It's cuddling together. It's just doing the simple things to express your love to one another. It's taking the time to get away and have a picnic or get away and walk in the park. Do something that you do alone. Something, use a little creativity every once in a while. Change it up. They don't like routine, okay? So change it up. Make it something special. I used to bring coffee home all the time, and I started realizing she can figure me out. So now I got to change it and make something different. They don't want to, don't be predictable, okay? Be creative, okay? So God given us that ability to be creative. We talked about physical touch. We're talking about having the right atmosphere. Women need to be held and caressed and tenderly touched. We're not talking about sexual advancements. We're talking about just touching and cuddling them and hugging them and letting them know that you care, you're there for them, hugging them and sharing with them through the emotional things that they go through with life. So I thought, how could I pull all this together as an example? Now, on our 25th anniversary a few years back, Sarah and I went to Paris. And we didn't bring the kids. We had a romantic weekend. We got away, okay? And so that we had a great time. We had a lot of fun. We got to see a lot of things. We got to do a lot of things. And that left a lot of great memories in our relationship. And so Valentine's Day was coming up. It was a few years ago. And I thought, I can't take her to Paris. But how about I bring Paris to her? So I'm not the most creative person, but somehow the creative juices began to flow. And so I thought, okay, I need to cook something. So I know she loves crepes. So I looked up on the internet and I started saying, okay. So I started looking at how to make crepes. Now, I didn't tell her. They like to be surprised now, guys. You don't tell your wife everything you do, because what happens if you don't do it, you just got knocked down because you told her you were going to do it. So I don't tell them that I'm going to do it, okay? That way she doesn't expect it if I don't do it. So I looked up a recipe. And so then I thought, okay, my wife is a little artsy, and she likes you to go the extra mile. So I think, well, Lord, help me. Help me to know how can I create the right atmosphere. So I took some leaves out of our table, and I pushed it closer together. I began to think about, what about restaurants? What's the romantic thing in restaurants? So I got some candles, and I put some candles on the table. And I thought about, well, I'll go on the internet, because our computer's right next to it, and I got some Parisian music, and I put some music on there, and so I dim the lights. We have a dimmer, and I dim the lights, and then I took her book on our trip. She put together a book of our trip, and I put it on the table. The book was on the table, and then she likes desserts, so I had some colorful desserts. Now, she was going to a basketball game with Connor, so I had the time to do it, so I put the desserts there. And then I thought, well, the table's got to look, she likes detail. So I took an old tablecloth that we used during the holidays, and I folded it up, and I laid it over the table. And then I found some of our white tablecloth, our white napkins, and put them on there and folded and put the silverware, not stainless steel, the silverware on there. And I put a little chocolate on the plate and everything else. I went the whole 9 miles, the whole 9 yards, whatever, okay? And so I enjoyed it because I was being creative. That is romantic love, is going the extra mile. Now, we don't do that. I don't do that all the time. I'll tell you right now. I'm just giving you an example. That was 2 years ago, too. So, but you don't have to do that all the time. And it's just little things. Just the little things that you show that you care. The little things that you do to let you know that you love them and you express it to them. We're talking about emotional part of your relationship. We're talking about romantic love. I can't stop talking about what can kill romantic love. Because before we go any further, let's talk about what are things that kill romantic love. Number one, nagging. Nagging. You know, when you think about what is nagging, you're trying to get your way. Now, typically, it's when we say nagging, I mean, guys can nag the girls, but typically it's the women nagging the guy. And so what he's doing is that her needs aren't being met, right? Her needs aren't being met, so she nags to get her needs met. Now, that's not being a servant, is it? That's about demanding. And so when the guy, he's like, well, if I give in to her nag, then I just reinforce that behavior. So there's a little battle going on. You're nagging and you're holding off and you're stonewalling. We learned about that. And so God doesn't want you to be a nag. All right? That's a killer of romantic love. Number two, being critical. Don't ever criticize her about her food. If you don't like it, don't say anything. But, I mean, I'm just telling you things I learned. I mean, just don't say anything about the food. And if you did, don't say it that night. That is a killer of romantic love. Sarah's a good cook. I just don't like split pea something. It was split pea over chicken or broccoli chicken or something. It was good chicken, but she put all this stuff over the top, you know. That was early in my relationship. That was early on, wasn't it, Sarah? It was before we had kids. And I don't do that anymore because I'm learning romantic love. That's a killer of romantic love. Okay. Hurtful and judgmental words. We have to be careful what we say. Now, there's times where you're going to say hurtful things. Be quick to ask forgiveness. Be quick to apologize. Just know that you need to resolve that so that love can grow. If you do things that are hurtful, get it right. You know, sometimes I can have a bad attitude, and Sarah catches it right off. I mean, when you've been living together for 29 years, I know her reactions, and I know that she knows when I, you know, we all mess up. But I know there's times where I'll come up, and it's like I get up on the wrong side of the bed. Can I have an amen? And you come down, and you're just kind of critical. And she doesn't say anything, but we don't have that eye-to-eye contact. So I know something ain't right. And so be quick to forgive. Be quick to ask for forgiveness. Be quick to apologize. Because when you do that, you get back in unity and you get working the right way. And maybe you have to talk about it and just say, I'm human. We're all human. When we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us for our sins. So be careful what we say. Own up to when you say it, just get it right and move on. Number two, we're talking about enjoying and having fun in our relationship. We talked about romantic love. The second we're going to talk about is the actual physical part of our relationship, the sexual part, the physical part of our relationship. And I want you to understand that there was an order in how we did things today. We talked about romantic love first. We talked about meeting each other's needs. For this plumeria to bloom, to get the super bloom, to have the intimacy in a sexual relationship, there needs to be these other things as part. There needs to be the super bloom that's put on that plant. There needs to be the romantic love. And all the women said, amen. There needs to be meeting each other's needs. Okay? And so we're talking about the physical part of a relationship. Proverbs 5, 18 and 19. Let the wife be a fountain of blessing for you. Rejoice in the wife of your youth. She is a loving deer, a graceful doe. Let her breast satisfy you always. May you always be captivated by her love. Joyous sexual expression of love between a husband and wife is God's plan. I'm going to share with you. I thought this was really good when I was going over this. Genesis 2, 24 through 25. This explains why a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife. The two are united into one. Now the man and his wife were both naked, but they felt no shame. They felt no shame. Now I don't know about this, well, what your situation is in life, but maybe you have viewed sex in a shameful way. Maybe your upbringing is that it was something you just do, you just tolerate it. But God doesn't want you to look at the intimate part of your relationship as being anything of shame. I'm going to show you how shame enters in, though. Genesis 3, 7. At that moment, their eyes were open, and they suddenly felt shame at their nakedness. Now, I didn't go through it, I should have, but I'll tell you the story. In Adam and Eve, when they took of the forbidden fruit, their eyes were all suddenly were open. And then at that time, shame entered in. Before, there was no shame. But when there was disobedience in sin, shame came in. Now, what I wanted to share with you is I don't know about your situation. I don't know about your past. I don't know what you've been through in life. I don't know what's happened with you. I don't know about your past relationships. I don't know any of that stuff. But what happens is we can carry the mistakes of our past. We can carry the things that we've done in the past, and we can become shameful because maybe we've done them out of disobedience, and we carry that shame with us into our next relationship. We carry the shame with us into our bedroom, and that breaks the intimacy of a relationship. Your sexual relationship is like a barometer of your relationship. And when that sexual part of your relationship is just really a hard thing, then that's usually an indicator of something else in your life needs to be dealt with. Maybe we need to go upstream and we need to begin to look at about how we're relating to our spouse and the things that we have said or things that we have done. But I want to go back to the word shame because I think it's very important that you learn about shame. Because when we are in disobedience with God, when we are in a relationship that's not honoring to God, that can open the door to shame. Because the Holy Spirit, when I share with these things, it's something that God wants between a husband and a wife. And so when we actively, knowingly just disobey God, then that opens the door to the enemy. And that's what they did with the forbidden fruit. It opened their eyes and they became shameful. And it brings shame into our relationship. And that's like a barrier that we carry along with us. God doesn't want you to live that way. It's like he doesn't want you to live condemned. What he wants you to do is to go to him, seek forgiveness, and repent, and to live through the power of the Holy Spirit the way that he wants you to live. He wants you to run to him, don't run from him. And so there may be areas of your life that you're shameful. God wants you to come to him. He wants you to be able to open up to your spouse and share those things. He wants you to seek help. He wants you, if there's areas of your life that you're battling with, seek help. Seek counseling. Let God heal you. God wants you to be that plumeria plant that's super blooming. He wants to see your relationship thrive. He wants you to give off the fragrance that he desires because he's called you together because his stamp is on marriage and he wants you thriving together, not just surviving together. So get help. Go to him. Seek forgiveness. Confess your sins to him. Turn away and let him drive out that shame in your life. Let's go back to the sexual part of a relationship. And so I'm going to make a little fun here, okay? So how does women view things, okay? I shared this earlier. I shared this with my wife, so this is not a man's perspective. All the women said amen. So, and I read a lot. I did a lot of reading, guys. I really did. I did a lot. I feel like I learned a lot. Sex without signs of love is sure to create resentment and lack of response. Sex without signs of love is sure to create resentment and lack of response. So what are signs of love? We talked about romantic love. That's what the woman needs to kind of prepare the time. So what are some things that are killers that a woman sees? Forgetting her birthday. That can kill it. Okay? Not caring about her emotional needs. Not taking the time to listen. Not taking the time to show. Those are things that is a reflection of her love. Well, for a guy, he's like, well, if you love me, we'll have sex. But a woman says, okay, but it's different for me. Are you doing the things that creates love in me to prepare me for this? Okay? Women's desire, that romantic prelude or the emotional component, is important before that sexual intimacy. The things that you do to express warmth and gentleness and softness and caring, that touching in those ways, those are important things to her that kind of helps to set the stage. Otherwise, it just looks almost like it's mechanical. Well, you just want sex, okay. It's not that. When you come together, that's an expression of your love for one another. And God wants it to be that part of romantic love and all the things that come together. What about men? How do they look at it? We said the number one need for a man is sexual fulfillment. Sex makes men feel wanted. Sex is a way for men to be received and accepted physically and emotionally. When the two come together as one, there's a closeness. And for a man, that closeness to him is that's an expression of that I really love, that I'm reserving just for you. And that's the closest nobody else shares. To them, that's extremely important. And so, there's things that, again, the men have to understand what they need to do for that to be prepared, but the women need to understand that that's important to him. I wrote down, avoidance of sex or the lack of response will affect the entire marriage in the most negative way. Now, I'm sharing all these things in context of marriage, okay? So, but it's good to know this now for those that aren't married. It's good to know this now so when you get married, you're learning these things, you're bringing these things into the context of marriage. But when you avoid, it's like to him you're driving a stake in your relationship. When you just try to withhold that, to him it's destruction of the relationship. Now, we need to go back and you need to begin to discuss why this has taken place. Because there's obviously you're not connecting in some areas of your relationship. Remember I shared before, the sexual intimacy is a barometer of the relationship, of the impulse of your overall relationship. And so God wants you to grow in this area of your life. But the thing is that it's honorable, marriage and sex in marriage is honorable in God's eyes. But God wants us to be able to share in those ways and to let that be part of our relationship. I wanted to throw in a couple little tidbits here. Now, I've had 3 kids, and I've been where you are, those that have young kids. And I've been in the busy schedule, having kids at baseball game and kids up late and kids at this and this. You need to take time for each other and the intimate part, or the sexual part of your relationship. You might need to be scheduled. You might want to come together and come to an agreement. But that needs to be a part of your, well, I'm just too tired. We're too busy. Okay, you need to slow down and make that a priority in your relationship. Because for a guy, that's extremely important. So you may have to work together. It's all about coming together and finding out what's a good time. How can we make this a part of our life? Begin to talk and begin to work through what are the things that are hindering us. What are things that, you know, all these things that I share, begin to communicate. If it's hard, I encourage you to go see a counselor. And begin to work on these things. Because for a man, it's extremely important. I believe it's just as important for a woman, too. And all these things are interwoven together. And God wants you to build that plumeria plant that's super blooming. And it goes by us learning these things. Here's my other one. Steak dinner and peanut butter. Now, this is all for the fun of it. Every time you come together in relationship, it ain't always a steak dinner. Okay? It ain't always a 4-course meal. It ain't always going to be, you know, everything is just fireworks and everything is great. Sometimes it's peanut butter and jelly. Sometimes it's just that you spent time together. You've had a busy week. But that doesn't define your relationship. The important thing in your relationship is that it's a positive, relaxing, pleasant, romantic, emotionally, and physically satisfying. Don't get, well, we didn't have we didn't go on a steak dinner and have all this romantic stuff. Sometimes it's just a quickie, but that's all right. It's okay. There's time and seasons for all those things. So when we're busy, sometimes we eat peanut butter and jelly sandwiches for dinner, and that's okay. We don't live like that all the time. And so it's okay that you can have. You know, I think for guys, sometimes it becomes, hey, I'm just being honest with you. Sometimes it becomes... It becomes a performance. I'm sharing with you. It becomes performance-oriented, and it's not performance-oriented, okay? Whether or not it was a great experience, it's not performance. It's about just enjoying the time together. And so maybe sometimes it's just enjoying the time together, and there's no sexual part. It's just hugging them because you're meeting the emotional need that's there, okay? It's not performance. It's not trying to work something up. It's about just spending time together, and God will create the environment that needs to be created. But your part is to do those things that we've shared already, okay? So let's do some numbers. Say you have sex 3 times a week, and you have it each time for a little over an hour. That's 3 hours a week. What about all the other 100-some hours that you spend together? How are you getting along together? Well, we don't really talk. We don't look each other eye to eye. Okay? That's just a little part of your relationship. So, all of us got to do our part. Amen? Number 3, we're talking about enjoying our relationship together. Spirituality. Hebrews 3:1. Brothers and sisters, you are holy partners in a heavenly calling. Matthew 6:21. Wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will be also. God wants you to share together spiritually. He wants you to do ministry together. You know, I think about it in our relationship, my wife and I. Early on when we got married, we were doing single adult ministry. I remember we used to go on mission trips and take people on mission trips. Then early on when we had children, we did children's. I was changing diapers. I was back in the nursery, working in the nursery. But we did ministry together. We do small groups together. Do life together spiritually. We talked about to have a healthy relationship. There has to be a spiritual component to that relationship. Grow in that relationship together spiritually. Do things together that you both share in spiritually. Here's a biggie if you take nothing away. Pray together. Pray together. I know we repeat it over and over again. Whatever it takes, but just start simple. But try to pray together with your spouse once a day. Maybe you can pray more than that. But just start somewhere. Pray together. You have sex together. You live together. Can't you pray together? Amen? Bring the spiritual component in your relationship. Do ministry together. Share what God is doing in your life. One of the greatest, neatest experiences of life is when Sarah and I do ministry together and see how God can use us to impact somebody else. That's a great experience. And that's all part of a relationship that God wants you to share in. He's the one that brings you together. Share ministry. He wants you to do ministry together. So let that be a part of your relationship. So we covered a lot today. How am I doing on time? I think I'm a little bit over. Hopefully you learned some things. Hopefully you've got a little super bloom on your relationship. Take some of these principles. Apply some of these things. You can go on the internet, look up his needs, her needs. You can download what are the five needs of a woman, what are the five needs of a man. Look at those things. Study those things. Talk about those things with your spouse. What are those things I need to work on? You know, we have a small group. Chris and Alona lead a small group in love and respect, and they couples get together, and they're not perfect couples. None of us are perfect, but they get together and they learn principles of how can they grow in their relationship with one another. You know, God's called you to live together. You might as well learn to get along with each other. You might as well learn how to cultivate happiness and love and joy and all those things in your relationship. But what they'll do is they'll help you to learn how to get some of the negatives out of your relationship that are destroying your relationship. And so we offer that as a small group. But take these things to heart. Continue on with this series. Next week we'll be doing another one in the series along a building relationship. Don't get down on where you are today. Just take some principles and God will help you be where you want to be in the future. Have a vision for what God wants in your life. Be creative. Use the thing that God's given you and build in a relationship with Him. So as we're going to take a little time to minister. And I just want to share real quick. Everybody can bow their heads. And I want to take a little time to pray. Because as I was putting this message together early on last week when Pastor Doug had asked me to do this, the Holy Spirit kept over and over again saying, shame. I think I even talked to Candace. She spoke about shame one time. And I said, where are those notes on that? I just felt like the Holy Spirit was wanting somebody. Maybe there's people in here that are battling in the area of shame. Maybe there's been some areas of disobedience in your life that's opened the door to shame. And God doesn't want you to live under condemnation. He doesn't want you to live under shame. He wants to break some things out of your life so that you don't bring that into your relationship. And I believe that comes by the blood of Jesus and that forgiveness that comes through His blood. God doesn't want you to go away today condemned and bound up in shame. He wants you to go away today forgiven and free. And so I'm going to pray over y'all today. Father, I just thank you, Lord God, that you came to set the captives free. And Father, I whatever people may be, maybe they're just embarrassed of their past. Maybe they've done some things that they're ashamed of. Lord, I thank you that when they bring it to the cross and leave it at the cross, they can walk away free. That Father, they'll turn away from the areas of disobedience and they'll say, Lord, help me to walk in purity to you. I'm going to live my life in a way that brings honor to you. Lord, I thank you that people are coming to a new level and a new freedom. Father, you come and you're setting them free, Lord God. That they begin to work and look at these things, Lord. You'll begin to show them things. You'll show them how they can, things that they can do in their relationship to help their relationship thrive and just not surviving, but thriving. Lord, help us to take these things to heart and to apply these things in our life. Now, with every head bowed, I always want to close up a service with giving people an opportunity to invite Jesus into their life. You know, it comes by decisions. It comes about, we talked about making the right choices. The most important choice you can start with is asking Him and allowing the Holy Spirit to come into your life. You know, you're not born a Christian. You become a Christian. You've got to invite His presence, the Holy Spirit, into your heart. You have to allow Him to come in, and that comes by personal invitation. And so I'm gonna lead us in that invitation. With every head bowed, I want you to pray after me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life. Be my Lord and my Savior. Thank you for dying on the cross for me. Forgive me of my sins. I make you the Lord of my life. You're the Savior. In Jesus' name, amen.